Hi students. So today we will discuss the interface of devices, of mechanical systems. We discussed in the previous lectures the controls, the display, and today we will discuss the interface. So what was the interface? The interface of a device is the layout, the way this is all of this, the layout of the equipments, meaning the controls and the displays, the way they are organized on this space, and this is called the interface. So this, for example, is the interface of whatever this device is. So the way everything is organized, the equipments means, if you see the word equipments, meaning the controls and the displays, okay? So how all of this is organized in relation to everything else, including the person. Because we should never forget that humans will be operating the device. So we should never forget the presence of the human and the human needs, okay? So this organization here, how is it organized, the equipments, in relation to the human? So the human can better use the device, better understand the device, safer to use the device, and so on. Now, good interface layouts help in what? To ensure that equipment, again, we have this word, meaning the controls and the displays, can be clearly identified. So whatever you organize here, if you're designing this device, how you organize the equipments, you must do in a way so that everything can be identified clearly. So I know what is this, what is this, what is this used for, and so on. The more clear, the better. For your target group of people you're designing for. The equipment has to be also easy and efficient to use. So all these equipments have to be designed in a way to be easy and efficient to use by the user. Also, errors have to be avoided, mistakes. So the design of this and the organization helps so that we prevent mistakes from happening. Before, when we discussed the controls only, we discussed about some guidelines, how to design controls to be well designed. Then we discussed things about the displays. Now, how if you design the controls well and the displays well, but you don't design the organization well, the way the layout of this interface, then we will have a big problem. So everything you might design in a good way, but if you fail in the way you organize them together at the interface, this can create a lot of problems, a lot of mistakes by the user, or confusion. So, designers must always examine and think about the tasks that the equipments, meaning the devices, are used for. You always must remember what tasks will be performed with this device, okay? Also, who is the target user? So these things here are very important in the design of the interface, how you design the interface. So what are the tasks? So what is the device? And what are the tasks that I need to perform on this device? Also, who are the users? It's very important. Also, what is the environment? So not only who are the target users, but also what are their abilities, limitations, measurements, everything about the user. The environment also, what characteristics does it have? Where is the device located? What does it mean, okay? How this can influence the use of it? Also, the equipment measurements. What is the device, and also what are the measurements, and how is this device going to be used? So you need to have a complete picture of the device, of its use, of the device and the user together with the environment, everything you must think about so that you make correct decisions about how to organize equipments at the interface and put the controls and displays in their what optimum location, the best possible location on the interface. So if you forget any of these, you will obviously not be able to design a correct interface layout. Here are some examples of some controls. Here are some labels. These examples are just to show you how important the very small details are in the design. So for example, what is the size of this? Okay, what is the size? What is even the space in between each one of these? It is not randomly put. Everything has a reason. Why do we put this amount of space and not for this kind of control and this device, for example, and not this kind of space? Why sometimes we have more bigger spaces, sometimes less spaces? Sometimes we have certain shapes of controls, and everything in them is important. Every single detail, the shape, the size of this, the size of this, the thickness. If something you have to hold with your fingers, the thickness is important, the height. Even the texture around, so my finger doesn't slip. Everything. This, for example, if it's a push button, okay, you need to know everything about the finger, everything for your target group of people to design it at a correct size. And for example, so that if I press this button, I don't press this by accident. Now, if they are too small and the designer doesn't take into consideration the finger and the hand requirements, measurements, then when you click, you might click another button by accident. Many, many things are important. So every detail, every single detail, what you decide to do when you design the equipments, meaning the controls and the displays, and then group them at the interface, every detail you need to take into consideration. The interface of a device have a certain space also. So you need to order whatever equipments you have in the best possible way inside a certain space. Some devices are small, some devices are big, so the control panel can be different. We will talk about this later in this lecture. Just notice that every detail matters. When you have a label even, look at the label. So what is the font you're using? Are you putting capital letters or small letters or combination? Is it bold, not bold? What is the space in between this, for example, and these? Everything is important. Everything is decided according to what? To the human needs. So that the human, to fit the human body, to fit the human need, or to make the human be able to understand better, to see better, to use whatever I'm designing in a better way, okay? So everything is for the human, to make the human be able to perform his tasks on this device in a best possible way. Now, there are some principles of layout of displays and controls at an interface, principles, like rules, okay? That would help any designer make kind of more correct decisions. So these four rules are important. So we will go over each one and talk about it, what it is. Now, by importance, what does it mean? Now, important equipment, meaning the most important controls or displays or any part of this equipment should be placed in a certain location Now, how do you decide how important something is? Okay, this is determined by how well you can achieve a certain task. So when you do a task analysis, for example, writing down the task steps, how do you do a certain task? How do you complete a certain task on this device? Okay, this would help you. This would help you decide which exactly controls could be, could play a critical role, a most important role, so that the user can perform the task. You need to decide which are more important than others. So the way you organize the more important controls at the interface will be at a location, maybe it's more easy to reach by the user, or it's in a location where it's more visible than the others. So you need to really understand how the user uses this device, moves with the device, and uses the controls and looks at the displays to be able to decide how to organize these by importance. So which are more important, which are less important? Now, for example, the on-off button. On-off, where you press on to make the device work and close it. Now, this button, it's very important. It's very important. Sometimes it's made with a different shape, with a different color, but it's not, for example, used all the time. So it's placed in a location which is not exactly in front of the user, you know? So some equipments can be as important as other equipments, but then you have to look at the other principles basically and decide according to them where to place. There is no 100 specific guideline how to do this. As I said, it's complicated because you have to look at the entire situation, how the human uses the device, what is the device, what tasks are performed. So a lot of decisions to be taken and even a lot of principles. So maybe I design something according to this principle, but it goes against this one. So I have to decide what is the best decision regarding the organization. So by frequency of use. Now, the on-off button that I mentioned, it's a very important button control, but it's not frequently used. So which controls am I using like all the time and which am I not using all the time? Like on a keyboard, okay? All the time I'm typing with certain keyboards, but the on-off button is at the side. It's placed at the side, not in front of me, because I'm not using it all the time. So it's important, but it's not used a lot. So it's placed at a location, not in front of the user all the time. Because if it's placed in front of me while I'm typing, I could make an accident, a mistake, and press off the computer. I can switch it off by accident. So this is not safe, not a good idea. So even if you decide some equipments are very important and you want to place it in front of the user, you need to see the other principles and decide, okay, maybe it's important, but is it frequently used? If it's not frequently used, you need to put it away from the user. If it's, for example, a control that if you press it by accident, some big mistake will happen in the device you're using. Also, if it makes it not safe for the user, again, you need to find the correct location for this kind of controls or displays. So by importance and by frequency of use. Now, by sequence, the sequence is also important to consider when you have controls, for example. By sequence, what is the order you're using certain controls to perform a task? Again, what is the tasks? What are the task steps? This is when you do the task analysis that we talked about before, it will become more clear. Then when you have each step identified, you can more easily decide, okay, what is the sequence of use of the controls so that I perform a task? Now the sequence is very important to be considered in the organization of the interface, because if you know exactly how a user performs a task. So I press this one first, then this one, then this one, then this one, then this one. Okay, for example, you want to organize the controls in a way so that the whatever movement of the body I make, it remains in a sequence, step by step, comfortably. For example, you don't want the user to do this kind of movements. Press one button here, then the other one here, then there, then over here, then go back here. You're making a lot of confusing movements, and the user cannot remember the sequence easily when you have to jump from here and there and here and there, okay? But if you have a nice ordered sequence of use, so I perform a task and I just move this way, for example, or this way, or in a very ordered manner without jumping around, then it's more easy for me to remember how to do the task. So you're making the life easier of the user, which is a very important ergonomic principle. It's safer. So for example, I don't make any mistakes. It's more clear. I will be more happier using the device. Many, many reasons, positive reasons. So organizing equipments, so the controls and the displays in a way that they follow the sequence of use to perform a task. This is very important. Even the movement of the body can be reduced, as I already mentioned, so you don't get too tired. Now, if it's a small handheld device, it's different than if you're using a big device. So if I have a very big device where I have controls here and here and here, and imagine you have to, your body has to keep moving up and down and doing all these movements, it's not, not a good idea. So how you organize the interface, it's very important for how the user will be able to interact with this device. Either it will be positive or negative experience. Now, by grouping according the function, this is another important principle to consider in the layout of displays and controls at the interface. So equipments, which means displays and controls, should be grouped according to their function. This is very important. So, for example, certain equipments, meaning, for example, certain controls. These are controls, okay, that perform a similar function, should be perform similar function in a task while the human performs a task, should be grouped together. Now, look at these, for example. You can clearly tell that this is a group. This is a group. This is a group, and this is a group. So when you, if you group something together, they have to be basically grouped by the function. What do they do, these buttons, or these, okay? So they have to perform similar functions. Look at these, for example, here. Look at these. Notice their shapes and their color, these oval shapes. Notice these, they are circular and black, different than these, okay? Now, I can clearly tell that this here is a group, this is another group. And even here, when I look, I can tell that this is alone, this button is alone, this is something, and this is something, and these two are also in a group. These are also kind of in a group. These are in a group, these are in a group. These two are different in function, but they have something similar in common. That's why the shape is the same, but they have different colors. So there is something different, very specifically different in their function. But because of the similar shape, they also have similarity and they are close to each other. So they are in a group and at the same time, not in a group. These are clearly in a group. These are clearly in a group. These are clearly in a group. So, it's very important for the organizations of interfaces to group whatever you have at the interface according to the function. So if certain, for example, controls have a similar function, You must find a way how to make it visible for the viewer that, yes, this is a group. And there are several ways to do that. So grouping can be achieved by the use of color. You can use color, for example, to make something look it is in a group by putting, for example, the same color, okay? Also shape, like for example, if I do certain controls with a certain shape and make others with another shape, and of course, where you place them, if you place them closer to each other, this will also make it look like this is a group and the others are another group. So the shape and the color, everything plays a role. Also the labeling. The labeling, what label do you put and how do you put it? Like for example, this is a label also, the numbers. Do you see the numbers? These are labels, but look, they are very different than, for example, these labels. As a size, they're different. As a color, they're different. Even the location can be different. Look, these, for example, all of these labels here use the same font, the same color, the same size. And this makes it look like this is a group. Also by demarcation lines, you can use demarcation lines to make certain areas of your interface look that as if it's a group. What is a demarcation line? Like these lines. Do you see these lines here? And this line here. So these lines also help to divide and organize the interface. By putting a demarcation line, I can really divide this from this clearly. And if I add additionally a color identification with shapes, with other things, it can make a clear identification of the groups that I'm organizing. So you need to use several methods, okay, to make it clear that these, for example, controls belong to this group. The others belong to another group. Functionally, it's very important to make the user understand that these, for example, controls function in a similar way rather than these. This helps in the understanding and in performing tasks correctly. Just notice around you, many devices in your home, you will find a lot of examples of these principles used, okay? Just recognize for practice, because when you do your projects, first you will analyze the device. If you're using a device for your project, you will have to first analyze. So look at the device, for example, this is your device, and find all the design mistakes in it. Using the principles of these principles that we discussed. So if you're finding the design mistakes in the interface here, you will have to look at each of the principles and decide, did the designer make a correct decision or not? If the designer made the correct decision, you need to explain why you believe that. If you think a wrong design decision was made in the interface layout, you need to also explain why, okay? Then when you have to design, for example, a new interface for this device, again, you will have to apply all the principles, everything that we discussed, to basically make design a better interface than the actual device. You will try to solve the problems that you mentioned, that this designer made certain problems here. There are certain problems in this design, so I need to solve them. Solve them how? By again applying these principles. So all of this that we discussed in the lectures can be used for analysis and for designing, solving the problems, okay, in the design. So now you need to notice and remember that in practice, in practical situations, these principles that we discussed cannot always be applied. So, because as I said, sometimes you design for example, layout to fit with one of the principles perfectly. But then when you go to the other principle, the second one or the third one, you will have to make some changes to the layout to fit with the other principles. So that the user can perform the task successfully. It's not always possible to place the equipments in their optimum position, meaning the best position, okay? Because as I said, sometimes when you design for one principle, it goes a little bit against the other. So you have to make compromises, set priorities and make compromises. So you need to see, you need to decide in this case, which is the more important thing that I need to design for, which is the priority here for the user to be able to understand, perform the task, be safe, not make mistakes, and so on. So you need to set the priorities. You need to decide which is the most important things that I need to consider. So principle one or two, or which one to focus on. And you need to make compromises. Sometimes you need to compromise. So you know that your design is not perfect, but I made it as perfect as I can according to the situation. So it will have somewhere a fault maybe, but I cannot solve it because it will go against another of the principles which I believe is more important. So always in designs, like you can hardly find any design that is totally perfect. There is always priority set and compromises made. Now, the design must always solve as many problems as possible, come as close as possible to perfection, but the things that you will leave out have to be minor problems. Minor problems. Remember the usability analysis that we discussed before? So there are minor problems in usability, difficult problems, and it gets worse and worse and worse. So the most worst problems in the design, you need to focus to solve them. Minor problems, if they are left, well, you have to set priorities. Priorities will mean I need to solve, for example, a safety problem in the device. This is more important than, for example, the safety is more important than, I could say, the comfort or the beauty of a certain part of the device. Now, all of them are very important, but if I have to set priorities, if I have to decide safety or beauty, no, you have to go with the safety. So this is what it means with setting priorities and making compromises, okay? In a design. Often you will end up with situations where you have to do this. So you follow as best as you can, for example, these principles, and then you have to decide where you have to set priorities and make compromises. The bad interface design can result in huge, huge disasters. Now, as I said before, even if you design the controls perfectly, everything about the controls, the shapes, the colors, the labels, everything is perfectly designed, the sizes. Then you do the same for the displays. You design them in a very good way. But if you fail to combine them, to organize them at the interface correctly, this can result in a total confusion. It's like everything, all the effort that you put in designing the individual elements will go to waste if you don't organize them correctly. The organization is very important. And when you organize, everything is important. The spaces in between, where you put, for example, the label, how far away from the or close to the control, on top of it, next to it, above it, below it, where do you put the display, for example? If you have several displays, how do you organize these to basically fit with the controls, to be compatible? It's not so easy. You have to take so many things into consideration. Then, where is the human going to be in all of this? Is he going to be standing, sitting? How is he going to be using this device? Is it a big device, handheld device? Am I using it in one hand? Am I using two hands to control it? Do I have to use my eyes only or also my hearing? Everything matters, okay? Now, let's talk a little bit about the panel, okay? The panel, it's the place where the interface is, like this device again. So in this case, this is the panel, okay? So we have certain, depending again on what device we are using, there are different panel shapes, okay? Now, this is clearly a flat, rectangular panel, okay? Now, for this kind of device, this is a good option. Now, this is also, I don't have a lot of devices here, but the ones I have. Now, this here again, it's flat, meaning it's not curved, okay? Flat. And again, it's like a rectangular shape. This, for example, okay, do you see this? This is also a device and it has a panel, but the panel, which is here, here are the controls, okay, where I click and when I use this with the mouse, but look, it is curved, okay? So this is a different panel shape. Now, when I look at it from here, it also goes in a rectangular way, but it also has certain curves and radiuses at certain points. This is because this is used in a different way than this, for example. So this has to fit, for example, with my hand shape. So it has other requirements. These here, for example, have to be reachable by my fingers. So other things that we discussed before in other lectures have to be applied so that I can use this correctly and comfortably. So the panel shape has to be designed in a way, considering again, this relationship between the human and the machine, the way it's used, the way it's held. Okay, this one, I will hold it like this and I will use it like this. And the display here, I also have to see while I'm using the controls. So the shape is a good choice. So just understand there are different panel shape designs. Again, it depends on what is the device, what is the device, okay? How do you use the device? How do you move your body to perform the tasks? Is it a whole body? You have to stand up, go to the device. Is it a big device, a small handheld device? How do you use it? Everything will guide you to decide what is the best panel shape design. Now this is about, they talk about here about workstations. Workstation means you're sitting on a chair and this in front of me is the workstation. So if I have, for example, to use something in front of me, it can be either flat or curved, for example, or sectional in this way. Now these are also flat panels, but they are shaped in a different way. So that, for example, if I move my hands, it goes more naturally instead of a flat, you know, straight rectangular shape like this one. It depends. Again, it depends what is it that I'm using in front of me. What is this device? To choose like this or like this or like this, or to make it even curved in a different way, like organic shape. Depends. It's very critical to decide the correct panel design shape for your interface, even before you design the equipments inside the interface. Now, it's very different if you have to use, for example, a device that is like this in front of you, and you are sitting on a chair. It's very different than holding a device in your hand and using it. So here again, we can see, look at the panel, how it's shaped, where the controls are. It's shaped according so that you can use it with your hand comfortably. If it's a device that's vibrating, for example, so that you have a good hand grip, so that you can reach, the controls are reachable by the correct fingers that they should be reached by, so that you can perform the task. So this is a mixer, it performs certain tasks. It's different than, for example, a computer, okay? It's different. So if you have to sit on a chair and you have here in front of you the device with the panel, it's very different than if you have a handheld device that you have to use. So the panel shape depends on this, on what is the device, what tasks are performed with the device. And the human body position, and of course the size, and how does the human going to look also. So for example, if you are stuck in a workstation like this on a chair, this is stuck, your body is here. You have to look in front of you, for example, at the computer, type, for example, okay? So when I look, for example, at my computer, there are certain angles that are comfortable to look. If I have to bend my head too much or too much up, too low or too high for a long period of time, so the time period is also important, then we will have health problems. So if you have to sit for 8 hours a day like this and your head to be up or down, we will have serious problems, okay? So how does this panel shape have to be designed so that the human is comfortable? At what angles? Where is the eye? How is the head going to be moved? So the angles are very important. If it's a handheld device, you don't need this. There are other requirements here that you need to take into consideration. So, always remember the user, the human that's using this device must always be seen as an integral part of the equipment layout design. Never forget the presence of the human, because this is, we are talking about a system here, okay? System means what again? The interaction between a human and the machine. This interaction makes it a system. So you cannot discuss the machine alone or design the machine alone without considering the human part of the system. It is a system. So when I'm designing something in the machine, I have to think about the human. What are the human needs? What are the measurements for the human? I cannot design the machine with ignoring the human. The human and the machine together, they are an integral part. So when I design anything, including interfaces, when I organize the interface, this must be always in my mind. So if you fail to do that, to consider the human and the machine as an integral part and design considering both in mind, okay? So you may end up with a bad interface design, and the human, for example, the user, will need more training to be able to use the machine, or the human will find it hard to understand how to use the machine. The performance may be reduced. Mistakes can become more common. Okay, so all kinds of problems can arise. Now some panel guidelines, okay, that will help you also to choose the correct panel, organize it in a better way. So for example, the location of the controls. The optimum area for location is between hip and shoulder. Here are some guidelines, okay? So the controls, the buttons, you know, it's best to have them located between the hip, okay, and the shoulder, somewhere in this space, okay, between your hip and the shoulder. Not, for example, in a place where you have to pick up your hands too high, or in a way that will cause the body to get tired, because my hands, from here to here, I have a certain size. So naturally, my hands, which I will be using in the control of the controls, it will be somewhere in this region. If they go too high or too low, we will have problems. Also, associated controls and displays should be placed near each other. So the compatibility between controls and displays associated. So if this display belongs to this control, we need to try to put them closer to each other. And it is advisable to have the control below the display, not the opposite way, not to have the display here and the control up here. The display should be up, the control down. It is more easy for understanding and a better option. Also, exactly where you place the control, a little bit to the right, to the left, or the display, this matters, or exactly underneath each other. Everything matters. Now, if groups of displays must be positioned separately from their controls, then the displays and controls should be positioned in the same order and arrangement so that there is control display compatibility. So if you have to put the displays alone and the controls alone, still they have to be ordered in the same way. So that I understand this display is for this control, the other display is for this control. Some kind of an organization. Not, for example, if you have here four controls and here, four displays and here four controls to make this control for this display, then this control for this display. Then so they have to, even if they're separate, they have to be organized in a way to make the user understand which belongs to which, to be compatible. So you have to make the most of the situation that you have. Discrimination of controls. So when you have a lot of controls, a lot of buttons, you know, they should be readily distinguishable. So you must know this one from this one. Like now, okay, we can recognize that all of these are a group because of the way they are designed, the colors, the shapes, everything. This is a group. So they have similar function. This is another group with similar function, but still, I need to recognize, okay, these have similar functions, but what is the difference between this and this, this and this? I still need to know. So this can be made by, for example, the label. There could be labels, okay, on on the controls or next to them or below them, explaining what is the difference between this and this. We know that there are similarities, but what are the differences? So the texture also can be changed, the shape. Now the shape, if you change the shape, it can make it look like it's not part of the group, okay? So if I make suddenly this one a square, it will look like it doesn't belong to this group. So if this is a group, they should have similar shapes and colors. But still there is a way with labels that I can make the difference. Now, if they are not in a group, I have the option to change the shape, to change the color, the labels. So to make it clear for the user, okay, to discriminate one control from the other, to understand what is the difference between this and this. Now be careful. You must really be careful. Do not combine too many shapes and colors and all kinds of things in a device, okay? You need to simplify as much as possible. If I can use the same shapes, but just, for example, change the color and the label, I would do that. If you change everything all the time, shapes, colors, labels, fonts, it will be a disaster, okay? So we must stick to similar shapes, but for example, I can use the same shapes, just, for example, put a line and make them organized in different groups. A little bit of change of color, a little bit of the label. It can all already make it very clear. But if I change everything about them, then it will become more confusing. It's like, don't add too much to the design. Sometimes it can make it worse, okay? Too many colors can make the design bad. If I use too many types of fonts, again, it's not a good choice in any kind of design. Shapes, the same thing, okay? So be careful. Regarding emergency operation, okay, there are some things you need to think about. When there is an emergency, the device must be able to alert you quickly. And you must be able to find where is the problem in the device quickly without delay. Because if you have an emergency situation, so the way the design is organized, the displays, the controls, everything needs to be in a way to make you see the problem quickly and solve it. Now, alarm systems should usually be combined with visual and auditory warning. It's not enough to have visual, you know, because what if you are not, for example, next to the device? If you're far away, I need to hear there is a problem. I need to hear so that I can go to the device and fix the problem. Again, it depends what is the device. But auditory displays are very important. So do you use only a visual or a combination visual and auditory display for warning? You need to be very careful and think about it. The equipments that deal with the emergency must be in a way placed that they can quickly be reachable, okay? Accessible to the user. So it's not something that I have to go several steps to reach or, for example, do unnatural body movements to get there. That's not a good choice. You must remember that people under stress, for example, when you have to deal with an emergency and you are under stress, okay, tend to revert to well-rehearsed habits. This means that any expected relationship between the control and the display becomes even more important in such cases when there is an emergency. So, meaning when your body is under stress, like something happening, okay, an emergency, you get under stress, your body starts reverting, starts going back to well-rehearsed habits, to your like habits that you are used to do. You're used to moving your body in a certain way. You are used to doing certain things in a certain way. So maybe I can do different things with my body when I'm not under stress. But when I'm under stress, my body starts doing the things naturally. What comes naturally? And the design must be designed in a way to allow people under stress, okay, when they start doing things the way they are used to. Okay, their habits come out during the stress. So to do the task correctly. So the way they are organized, the controls and the displays at the interface in such a situation is even more important. What can we give an example for this, for example? In an airplane, the pilots in an airplane, okay, they have in front of them a lot of controls, a lot of displays. And they are not under stress. They're flying the airplane and they're using the controls, you know, as they have learned. Everything is cool. But when something happens, the airplane wants to crash, what happens to the pilots? They get under stress situation. And this will start now when you're under stress in this situation, very dangerous situation, that all these controls and displays in front of you, what you have learned will become very difficult to keep your mind calm and to use everything around you in a correct way. So you might, for example, press a button by mistake, do something by mistake because you're under stress. So how this design of the interface of the control panel of even the individual controls and displays can help you in this kind of situation under emergency. Now, most devices you will come in contact with in your home, they are not this dangerous, you know, like they cannot cause a tragic accident if you're under stress, but I mean, in certain devices, it can. For example, if you're driving a car, you have in front of you an interface. So, when you're driving a car, it's the same like flying an airplane. You could end up in an accident and it could mean life or death. So whatever you have in front of you should be designed in a way to help you deal, in case you are in an emergency, to deal very quickly with your habits, the old habits that you have, okay, in a way, correct way, and to stay safe. User comfort. You always have to design panels, okay, and interfaces in a way to reduce muscular fatigue, meaning the body not to get tired, okay? So the tasks that you need to perform, so the design of this panel, okay, in front of you needs to be in this way so that it will allow you to change your position of the body to be comfortable. This is especially true when you're stuck in a workstation, in a chair, for example, for the entire day. So whatever your design is of the workstation should be in a way to allow your body to move sometimes. Frequently used controls, or controls that need an amount of strength, certain strength, okay, should be positioned close to you. As your hand movement is most accurate, nearer to the body. So if I have a control that I need to push, for example, with more force, it is better to be located closer to the body rather than far away. If it's far away, I don't have the amount of strength or accuracy in my hands to do that. But if it's close to my body, I can move more accurately, I can control what's in front of me more accurately, and also use amount of strength which is bigger than if it's far away from me. Accuracy and strength are reduced if control movement is across the body or in a direction away from the body. So the way you control a certain control, now some controls, you know, you push them, some controls you rotate them, some controls you have to do this kind of movement. So it depends what type of control it is, what kind of a machine you're dealing with. So how do you control it? How do you move your body to do the task? Certain movements are important. So do I control it this way? And need now, if it's something, a control that needs a lot of strength, this way it's not a good option. This way it's a better option. My hand is stronger this way than this way. Okay. Also up and down, you need to decide. Now, if you have small controls, maybe this is not a big issue, but some machines have really big and controls that are heavy, need force. So it depends again, what is the machine, okay? And how the tasks are performed to decide on these issues. So these are general things. Maybe you don't need them, for example, in the device that you will be dealing with in your project. But these are things that need to be known by designers in case in future they will be dealing with such a situation. And these are very general things that we talk about. There are so many more detailed things that you need to read about to understand before you actually can do a correct design of an interface of a device. So these are the very, very basic stuff, very basic that we talk about. Okay, so it's the end of our lecture today about important things that need to be taken into consideration in interface design. Okay, in the design of interface, ordering and organizing the equipments, displays and controls. So as a final thing, if you look at this, for example, interface, imagine, look at how many controls there are here. So many. These are controls, these, for example, these, all of these are controls. This is a display. These are also controls here. So imagine if the, the things that we discussed are not applied in this design. Imagine if it's not organized. Imagine if these buttons, for example, or these ones, or these are not organized according to function. Look at all of these things here that we can see. It can create a confusion because we have a lot going on, a lot of stuff going on. So the organization of this interface is very, very important for to make things clear for the user or more easy to understand. Look at the labels. Notice the labels, how they are designed, okay? Notice the colors. Notice the background color and the color of the, for example, the controls or these or the labels on top of the controls. Why are some of these, okay, why are these shapes all the same? But this one is red. So these are clearly in a group, but this one is something also performs something else than the rest. It's something a little bit more different. So look at these controls. They also have lights next to them, indicator lights. So everything matters. Why are these lines, for example, put here? Why is this label put here and not in the middle? Why are these, for example, here put on top of this control and not at the bottom? Everything has a reason. Everything. Why are these made to rotate and not to be pushed? Why are these three, shape, the circle, for example, but they are smaller than this, for example, or this? Why are these controls, for example, these put together in a group, in a circular group, and not in a different way? So everything must have a reason. But also remember that the designer of this made compromises, often made decisions, which he tried to solve, for example, the biggest problems, but maybe some other problems are still here. And sometimes you see designs with very big problems unsolved. Then you definitely have to solve them. So if you had to analyze this device, for example, okay, according to all its design problems, you have to follow what we discussed, and according to each, discuss what is it, why is it correct or not correct as a design? So where are the problems? You have to do a lot of analysis. Task analysis, usability analysis, then consider all the points that we discussed. Did the designer take them into consideration? If yes, how? Why is this, for example, a correct color or a wrong color? You need to discuss, you need to talk about, you need to explain everything, okay? And you will be dealing with such things in your project. So the deeper your thinking, the deeper your understanding, the more observant you are of the details, the small details, okay? The better. And the more general you are and not looking at the details, not considering everything, the less good result will be your project. So this is it for today. Thank you for watching. Please understand the things that we discussed as usual, because we are getting closer and closer to the exam, okay? That will be in the beginning of April held. So please look at every detail that we discuss and understand it as best as you can. Thank you.